Greetings, friends and brethren. This is Dr. Bob Teal, Continuing Church of God. Today I'd like to talk about Christians, violence, and military service. Now, if you've been in the Church of God for a long period of time, you probably have an idea what the general position has been. But I'd like to go through scriptures, I'd like to go through some lessons of history, and perhaps some scriptures you hadn't considered in this particular light before. And of course, most important is, you know, what does the Bible teach about this? Now, in James chapter 4, verses 1 through 2, it said that wars come from covetousness. And historically, the proper Church of God position has been that true Christians should refrain from being in the military. And if they are in the military, then they're not supposed to be violent or to harm anyone. And that's consistent with what it says in the book of John 18, verse 36. However, back in 2001, right after the 9/11 incident, a Church of God related publication started to run articles from people who took a different perspective. Those who varied from the old Church of God perspective, the position that, for example, the late Herbert W. Armstrong held, or what we currently hold in the Continuing Church of God. Since I mentioned Herbert Armstrong, I'd actually like to read something that he wrote as part of the fundamentals of belief of the old Radio Church of God, which is the organization that preceded the old Worldwide Church of God. And he wrote, "We believe that Christian disciples of Christ are forbidden by him and the commandments of God to kill or in any manner directly or indirectly take human life. By whatever means, we believe that bearing arms is directly contrary to this fundamental doctrine of our belief. We therefore conscientiously refuse to bear arms or to come under the military authority." And this idea was not unique to Herbert Armstrong. Back in 1917, G.G. Rupert, who used to have some affiliation with a Seventh-day Church of God group himself, he wrote, quote, "I prefer to lose my life than killing someone under a fit of enthusiasm or imaginary loyalty. Of course, those are written by humans. What did Jesus say? What did the Son of God say? Well, if you've got your Bibles, go to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, and I'm going to read verse 21 and part of verse 22. Matthew 5, 21. "You have heard that it was said to those of old, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment.' But I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of judgment. Whoever says to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. Whoever says, 'You fool,' shall be in danger of Gehenna fire." And in Matthew 19, verse 18, you don't need to go there, but Jesus said, "You shall not murder." As Jesus' comments in Matthew 5, 21, 22 demonstrate, he expanded the restrictions against murder. And those expansions normally do not condone normal carnal warfare or engaging in violent sports. And actually, you know, many who are involved in carnal sports encouraging violent sports get improperly angry, I think, when they watch them. Now, what did the Apostle Paul teach? Well, if you want, we won't spend a lot of time in 2 Thessalonians 2. I'm going to read one verse, and I'm going to go over to Romans 1. But in 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 12, the Apostle Paul wrote, "They all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness." And seeing people pound on one another certainly is pleasure in unrighteousness. But let's go to the book of Romans, chapter 1. I'm going to read a few verses, starting verse 28. Again, this is from the Apostle Paul, Romans chapter 1, starting verse 28. "And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting." Verse 29, "being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness," remember, wars come from covetousness, "maliciousness, full of envy, murder," and Jesus expanded murder to not just be the physical act, but also in one's heart, or even to be get improperly angry, "strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who, knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those practicing them. So Christians aren't supposed to be entertained by violence, participate in violence, or approve violence. Yet many people, probably most, who have some affiliation with the Church of God seem to condone physical violence, at least when it comes to things such as sports that have been proven to be harmful to the participants. Now, the Apostle John was the last of the apostles to die, as far as we can tell. And after he died, into the second century, there are various ones who wrote. Now, some people wrote who professed Christ, and they were not actually part of the Church of God, and others were part of the Church of God. But even at that time, during the second century, what we now know as the Greco-Roman churches, for example, the Roman Catholic Church, the Eastern Orthodox churches, and the forerunners, if you will, the Protestant churches, they all, without exception, all the major groups at least, did not believe that Christians should participate in carnal warfare. So let me read something from a Catholic and Orthodox, and I guess Protestant saint, if you will. It's not God saint, I don't think. I'm sure. A name Justin Martyr. In around 150 AD, here's what he taught. For from Jerusalem there went out into the world 12 in number, and these illiterate, of no ability in speaking. So that's interesting. He said the people that went out, they weren't polished speakers or anything. But by the power of God, they proclaimed to every race of men that they went by Christ to teach in all the word of God. We who formerly used to murder one another do not now, only now refrain from making war upon our enemies, but also that we may not lie nor deceive our examiners, willingly die confessing Christ. So he said, you know, we used to be murderers. We don't do that anymore. And then he also, that was in his first apology, chapter 39, for those who want to know about that. And in his dialogue, chapter 110, Justin wrote, who, having learned the true worship of God from the law, the word which went forth from Jerusalem by means of the apostles of Christ, have fled for safety to the God of Jacob and God of Israel. And we who were filled with war and mutual slaughter and every wickedness have each, through the whole earth, changed our warlike weapons, our swords into plowshares, our spears into implements of tillage. And we cultivate piety, righteousness, philanthropy, faith, and hope, which we have from the Father himself, through him who is crucified, and sitting each under his own vine. So we see Justin saying we're not supposed to be participators in carnal warfare. But again, I don't believe he was part of the Church of God, but I would like to read something from Melito of Sardis. He was in the Church of God. He was a pastor or bishop. And this is what he talks about in terms of what happens if you have a just leader. And this is from a discourse which was in the presence of Antonius Caesar. Again, this is Melito. My opinion is this, that in this way a kingdom may be governed in peace when the sovereign is acquainted with God, with the God of truth, and is withheld by fear of him from doing wrong to those who are his subjects, and judges everything with equity as one who knows that he himself will also be judged before God, while at the same time those who are under his rule are withheld by fear of God from doing wrong to their sovereign, and are restrained by the same fear from doing wrong to one another. So basically he's saying, look, if you have a truly Christian leader and truly Christian subjects, they're not going to go around harming each other. By this knowledge of God and fear of him, all evil may be removed from the realm. If the sovereign abstains from doing wrong to those who are under his rule, and they abstain from doing wrong to him and to each other, it's evident the whole country will dwell in peace. Therefore, he's saying that if it's not dwelling in peace, these people are not doing what the Bible says. They must be violent. Many blessings, too, will be enjoined there, because amongst them all the name of God will be glorified. For what blessing is greater than this, that a sovereign should deliver the people who are under his rule from error, and by his good deed render himself pleasing to God? For from error arise all those evils which the kingdom suffer. But the greatest of all evils is this, when a man is ignorant of God, and in God's stead worships that which is not God. So Melito is saying, look, if we people will worship the true God and believe God, they'll have peace. Now, I'd like to read something from Tatian. Now, he was a professing Christian apologist. I don't believe he was in the Church of God. But around 170, he wrote, "And for these, the witnesses take their seats, and the boxers," that's talking about boxing, "meet in single combat. For no reason whatever, nor does anyone come down to the arena to succor. Did such exhibitions as these redound to your credit? He who is chief among you collects a legion of blood-stained murderers, engaging to maintain them. And these ruffians are sent forth by him, and you assemble at the spectacle to be judges, partly of the wickedness of the adjudicator, and partly of the men which engage in combat. And he who misses the murderous exhibition is grieved because he was not doomed to be a spectator of wicked and impious and abominable deeds." So there were some in the professing Greco-Roman world who apparently thought that they should watch violent sports such as boxing. And Tatian said no. And here's another one from Athenagoras. He was also a professing Christian apologist, also wrote around 170. He also was not in the Church of God. He says, "What man of sound mind, therefore, will affirm, while such is our character, that we are murderers? Who does not reckon among the things of greatest interest the contests of gladiators and wild beasts, especially those which are given by you? But we, deeming that to see a man put to death is much the same as killing him, have abjured such spectacles." So he's saying, look, if you watch people being murdered, it's like you're participating in the person's murder. And I would also suggest it's the same thing if you're talking about watching somebody who's participating in violent sports. Now, I'm not saying if you're somewhere and a TV flashes by and you see some violent act or something. I'm not talking about that. But I'm talking about people who intentionally encourage and watch violent entertainment, violent sports. Now, there's make-believe entertainment. That's not real violence. But I'm talking about, for example, sports such as boxing and American football, where when they are properly, if I can use that word, played according to the rules, someone gets hurt. And while someone might argue that, you know, the intention of American football is not to harm people, if you look at all the studies, the reality is it does harm people. And again, people are being violent in the sport, and people who watch it are encouraging violence, and it seems to give them adrenaline rushes or whatever. Now, I'd like to read something from Theophilus of Antioch. Now, I believe he was in the Church of God. He was the bishop or the pastor of Antioch. And around 180 he wrote, "Consider, therefore, whether those who teach such things can possibly live indifferently and be commingled in unlawful intercourse, or, most impious of all, eat human flesh, especially when we are forbidden so much as to witness shows of gladiators." He said, we're forbidden to watch violent sports, lest we become partakers and abettors of murderers. But neither may we see the other spectacles, lest our eyes and ears be defiled, participating in the utterances there sung. So again, this is Theophilus of Antioch, a Church of God leader, says, look, we're forbidden as Christians to even watch the gladiator games. Now, I know some people think, oh, that's because other Christians are always being fed to lions and all that. Well, actually, not most of the time in the gladiator games. And it was entertainment to the masses, but Christians felt that they were not supposed to participate in that. So consider, if they weren't supposed to watch violence, obviously they weren't supposed to participate in it. That would include military service. Now, interestingly, there's a 3rd century Catholic theologian named Hippolytus. He was a bishop of Rome. And they had some standards. You say, well, it's got to do with the Church of Rome. I said, well, again, the original Church of Rome was actually had faithful Christians. And even though by the 3rd century a lot of compromise had come in there, even in the 3rd century, the Church of Rome was opposed to military participation. And this is important because you've got the Protestants who trace their history, if they're technically proper Protestants, through the Church of Rome. And so they might be surprised to what some of the standards for being a church member were. He says, here's the people, these are the jobs, by the way, they rejected. If you were in these jobs, you couldn't be in the church. A charioteer, likewise, and one who participates in the games, or who goes to the games, he shall cease or be rejected. You couldn't be a you couldn't be driving chariots in these games. You couldn't be going to the games. You couldn't be participating in the games, or you'll be rejected. You couldn't even watch. Some is a gladiator, or even teaches the gladiators how to fight, or who goes in the arena, or public official concerned with gladiator shows. He shall cease or be rejected. If some is a priest of idols or an attendant of idols, he's going to cease or be rejected. A military man in authority must not execute men. If he is ordered, he must not carry it out, nor must he take military oath. If he refuses, he shall be rejected. One's a military governor, he shall cease or be rejected. The catechumen or faithful who wants to become a soldier is to be rejected, for he has despised God. So again, these were standards back then. Even in the beginning of the 4th century, the Catholic apologist Lactinius, two different spellings, wrote, "For when God forbids us to kill, he not only prohibits us from open violence, which is not even allowed by public laws, but he warns us against the commission of those things which are esteemed lawful among men. Thus, it will neither be lawful for a just man to engage in warfare." And here's something else he wrote. "Or why should he carry on war and mix himself with the passions of others when his mind is engaged in perpetual peace with men?" As Christians, he's saying, our mind is supposed to be engaged in perpetual peace with men. Christians consider it unlawful not only himself to commit slaughter, but to be present with those who do it and to behold it. Now, I'd like to read something from what I consider a misnamed publication called Christianity Today. They recognize that the early Christians were against military service. Then they wrote, "The ancient church understood that war has been around as long as human beings and sin have coexisted. It's a consistent tenet throughout the Christian tradition that war is a result of sin. The response to war, however, have followed two basic trains of thought: pacifism and the idea of that certain wars are just to be fought." Then they talk about pacifism. Pacifism is characteristic of the early centuries of Christianity. And for example, they quote the apologist Tertullian, 160 to 220 AD, who wrote, "How will he serve in the army, even during peacetime, without the sword that Jesus Christ has taken away? Even if soldiers came to John and got advice how they ought to act, even if the centurion became a believer, the Lord, by taking away Peter's sword, disarmed every soldier thereafter. We are not allowed to wear any uniform that symbolizes a sinful act." And the Roman bishop Hippolytus, again, I'm quoting from a writing in Christianity Today, said, "A soldier in the lower ranks shall kill no one. If ordered to do so, he shall not obey. He shall not take an oath. If he doesn't want to comply with this directive, let him be dismissed by the church." And this is from Ancient Christianity Commentary on Current Events, What is War Good For? It was posted in Christianity Today, October 28, 2003. So even the Protestant publication Christianity Today recognized that the Christians did not participate in warfare. Hippolytus, by the way, also said, "It is not appropriate for Christians to bear arms." And Tertullian, which I mentioned before, basically said that you're not supposed to fight, so I'm not going to read all of those. But I would like to read something from a person who used to be a Protestant, and now is probably more of an agnostic. He's a scholar. His books are in a lot of the bookstores. His name is Bart Ehrman. And here's something that he noticed, or he reported about, the difference between the Jews and the early Christians. He says, "Further indication of a separation of Christians from Jews came soon thereafter in Jewish uprising against the Romans in Palestine, leading to a three-year war and ultimate destruction of Jerusalem and a temple in the year 70 AD. Okay, so we're talking about 70 AD. This is almost 40 years after Jesus was crucified, so this is 67 to 70 AD time frame. Quote, "Old traditions indicate that the Christian Jews refused to participate in the struggle." So in other words, while the Jews, after Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection, were still fighting, the Christians back then were not. I'd also like to read something from the Protestant historian Kenneth Scott Laurette. This is what he said about 3rd century Christians. Perhaps most of the early Christians had conscientious scruples against military service. Well, I would say all the real Christians actually always did. And then he says, after, you know, but a compromise of the world became a serious peril to the gospel. And this is, he's saying this happened after Emperor Constantine. And I would say that that was definitely one change that Emperor Constantine did implement, and I'll get to that later. But I'd like to read something from a former Catholic priest who says kind of the same thing. This is from a Peter de Rosa. Whereas up to the year 175, so up to about 175 AD, according to him, there was not a single Christian soldier. In 416, by an edict of Theodosius, only Christians were allowed to enlist. So somewhere between 175 and 416, according to this particular researcher, the Roman Empire went from having no Christian soldiers to all Christian soldiers. Now, I would challenge that and say that those who became soldiers later were not true Christians. But this was a compromise that happened. Now, in later centuries, this violent trend actually increased. I'd like to read something from the Catholic Encyclopedia. It talks about Pope Leo V, though an iconoclast, that means he was against idols, tried to refute the accusation that he was a Paulician by persecuting them furiously. And that was one of the issues, that the Paulicians, some of which were in the Church of God, they didn't believe in worshiping idols or having idols. And so some people thought Leo, because he kind of had a position similar to that, maybe he was a Paulician. So to prove that just because he didn't advocate idol worship, he was not a true Christian or not a Paulician, he started persecuting them violently. A great number of them at this time rebelled and fled. And so this was a problem. The true Paulicians didn't fight back. They fled. Now the Paulicians were followed by groups known as the Bogomils, as well as some called the Albigenses. I'd like to read something from a Harvard scholar and Protestant, Dr. H. Brown. He wrote, in Slavani, the name Bogomil means beloved of God. The specific predecessors of the Bogomils are the Paulicians. Many Bogomils, especially their leaders, exhibited a zeal and purity of life that contrasted with the indifference and frivolity of all too many Orthodox ecclesiastics in both the East and the West. Furthermore, he said, Bogomils and Cathars were communities of non-violence. Okay? So other scholars have noticed this. The faithful Christians were always non-violent. So if you're a true Christian in this day and age, do you condone violence? Do you encourage violence? Do you participate in it? The Catholic Encyclopedia talks about the Bogomils. It says, the heresy of the Bogomils started in the 10th century. Followers called themselves Christians and considered their faith was the only true one. That would make sense. In Bosnia, they were named Paterines. The Paterines or Bogomil forbade intercourse with those of other faiths, disbelieved in war. Again, throughout history, we see this. Now, the Albigenses were pacifists, and sometimes they got turned in by the Catholics, and sometimes they were killed. I'd like to read something else from former priest De Rosa. It has been reckoned that in the last and most savage persecution under Emperor Diocletian, about 2,000 Christians perished worldwide. And some of those were probably real Christians, some probably were not. But listen to this. In the first incident of Pope Innocent's crusade, 10 times that number of people were slaughtered. Not all were Albigenses. It comes as a shock to discover that at a stroke, a pope killed far more Christians than did Diocletian, who was the so-called pagan Roman emperor. Again, I don't know if everybody that Pope Innocent got killed were actually true Christians, but he killed people who professed Christ. And according to Priest De Rosa, 10 times as many as Diocletian had killed. Now, into the Middle Ages, some of the true church were called Waldenses, or Waldenses. Now, not everybody called that name were actually in the true church, but the Waldenses were pacifists. Let me read something about them. Their opposition to bearing arms and to all war and all its operations was unanimous and unequivocal. Whoever commanded them to the field, they refused to obey, alleging that they could not conscientiously comply. So again, throughout history. I mention this because the idea of the Church of God, the continuing Church of God, of being pacifist in the sense that we will not kill and we do not advocate watching violent sports, is consistent not only with the Bible, but with writings from Christians and professing Christians in 2nd, 3rd centuries up in time to the Middle Ages. I'd like to read something from the 13th century, and it says, the perfecti were pacifists. They died with dignity. Basically, a lot of the crusaders sometimes decided to kill what they called heretics at the same time. So that's throughout the 13th century. And by the way, this had the Pope's approval, according to Priest De Rosa, and they recorded that they killed 400. They burned them in a fire. Well, actually, they tried to kill 400, but one renounced his faith. Okay, so there was an apostate amongst them, but they killed them, and it was put on record for the Pope's benefit. How could a Pope think this is appropriate? Well, only if he doesn't believe what the Bible says and has a different view of war. Now, let's see something that Jesus wrote. Go to the book of John, chapter 16. John 16. Verse 2. Yes, the time is coming that whoever kills you will think he offers God service. Isn't that what the popes were having people do? And these things they will do to you because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things I have told you, when the time comes, you may remember I told you of them. And these things I did not say to the beginning because I was with you. Now I'd like to read something the Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Timothy 3. But again, notice that Jesus said they're going to do this because they don't really know me. They think they're doing God's service. And the crusaders and others sadly had this belief. Anyway, 2 Timothy 3. All right, verse 12. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. And the popes and others have tried to ensure that. But evil men and imposters grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But you must continue the things which you have learned and be assured. One of the things you've learned to be assured, you don't have to go there, but Romans 13:10 says, love does no harm to a neighbor. And of course, violence does do harm to neighbors. Now consider Paul's writings with something else. This again, this is Priest De Rosa writing. In 1520, Pope Leo X condemned Martin Luther for daring to say that burning heretics is against the will of God. Okay? They thought that, of course, you should burn heretics. They thought it was God's will. Now, in the 1800s, there was a lot of controversy within Church of God circles and groups who claimed to be Church of God. Some were in favor of military participation. Some were not. But the faithful generally were opposed to it. It used to be in the United States, in the early United States, if you were against being part of the military, you could just basically pay a fine and you wouldn't have to go. Quakers did that, Church of God people did that, and all that was going on until somewhere around the Civil War. Now, the late Richard Nichols wrote that some Advent groups attempted to buy exemption from the draft for the male members. Now, when he says Advent groups, the group that's now called Church of God Seventh Day, well, they did change a bit, they got more, they've had various changes, but in the 1800s, were called Church of God Adventists. So when he says Advent groups, Richard Nichols was referring to Church of God groups who use that, or groups that claim to be Church of God who use that. And there was an Eli Wisley of the Hartford Church of Christ. He spent 4 months in prison for refusing to fight with carnal weapons. And there was one report was that one of the brethren by the name of William Cronk of Casco was drafted. He passed examination, but he was declared exempt from field service on account of his religious principles. And the government made him go and work in a hospital, I guess, as a volunteer. And there were others that they were trying to raise money for to try to get him out of this. There was one person who had been the president at the Michigan Conference. He enlisted in Union Army, and the Waverly Church disfellowshipped him. So they wouldn't allow someone with them who had gone into the military. And there were others back in 1917. A.N. Duggar, who you may have heard of, the late Herb Armstrong knew him. He went with a Missouri congressman and had a personal interview with then-President Woodrow Wilson, obtaining a Church of God exemption from the draft related to World War I. So historically, it has been a Church of God position to stay away from being part of the military. Now, I'd like you to go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm going to read just one verse, just the first verse. 1 Timothy 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith. So this is warning us that some who are supposed to be faithful will depart. And sadly, military service is one of those areas that has happened. The church that took over the old Worldwide Church of God, by the way, actually put an active military officer in charge of several congregations in one of the distant states. On the other hand, there are groups who try to kind of have it both ways. Leader of one Church of God group said, Christians should renounce such carnality and the weapons of human strife and should not participate in military combat through the armed forces. Now, of course, that makes sense, and that is the Church of God position. But sadly, this particular individual also wrote, you should know that over the years I've defended the church's pacifist stance, but that the events of September 11th has me thinking much about this. Would you say that this is a different kind of war against America calls for exception to the rule? So he was starting to wonder if perhaps his church should no longer be pacifist. There's another Church of God group. They were asked if they believed their members should be in the military, and basically says it's a personal decision. It says, we need to stress God's kingdom is not of this world, and we're called to be separate and trust in faith. And I believe it's personally better not to come in the military, but we don't condemn anyone who makes a different decision as long as they allow us that courtesy. So in other words, this other Church of God group says, look, if you don't say I have to be in the military, we won't kick you out if you do go in. Another group says that they have no policy against their members serving in the military. And still another says a Christian could serve in the military, and he basically says he thinks there's a time to fight. And that's not consistent with what Jesus wanted his followers to do. And there was another small group that, again, I'm intentionally not mentioning these groups' names. If you want more details, I have the exact quotes in an article that's at the cogwriter.com website. It's called Military Service and the COGs. Do real Christians participate in carnal warfare or encourage violence? So you're welcome to get all the names and whatever. But in the sermons, I find that I don't think that's necessary. This one person says he believes the Church of God's groups have it all wrong. He's the founder of this particular church. He says you should do what pleases God. Do not intimidate anyone or accuse falsely. Be content with wages. John the Baptist advised the military men. John didn't say you have to go AWOL or resign. He didn't say you've got to put down your weapons. And he says, I've always believed it's good to fight against evil. And I'm saying we can't tell our young people they can't join the military. I can't support in the scripture to deny the military service they feel moved to serve. Well, later in this sermon, I hope to prove to you that you can tell from scripture. But many, again, have fallen away from the faith, and they just don't get it. There's actually an elder in what was probably the largest Church of God group. They asked him about if it's wrong to be in the military. His response was, that's a pointed question. The question is, should a COG member join one of these killing organizations? Should he submit to the draft in times of military conscription? He says, I can't speak for anyone but myself, but I'm not saying that a Church of God kid should not join the military. It's a purely personal choice. They're doing what they think is right, and I do what I think is right. So I find that disturbing. I don't think elders and ministers in the church should go out and say it's okay if your young people want to just go part of the military. And again, I've got more quotes from more people who are leaders or writers in various Church of God groups that take the wrong particular position, that they believe that it's okay in order to participate in military. And of course we have now, as I said before, almost all Church of God groups teach that it's okay to encourage violence in sports, which I think is wrong. But let's go more to the Bible. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. I'm going to read what the Apostle Peter wrote. I skipped over a lot of what the people who support being in the military say. Basically, they say you're part of your nation, you pay taxes, you get benefits from your nation, therefore you should go out and be a regular part of your nation and participate in things such as the military. But notice what Peter wrote. 1 Peter 2, starting in verse 9. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but now are the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. So he's saying, before you were in the church, you were just part of the world, you were not really a people, but now you're a people, a special people, a royal people, a holy nation, God's holy nation, Jesus Christ's holy nation. You're not, therefore, part of the nations of this world. Yes, we still pay our taxes. And by the way, at our Bible News Prophecy channel, we do have a video that you can watch about whether or not Christians should pay taxes. We also have an article at the cogwriter.com website if Christians should pay taxes. And Jesus, we believe, clearly taught that Christians should pay taxes. But we also believe he taught that Christians were not supposed to fight. Now, in Philippians 3, verse 20, it also says our citizenship is in heaven. So again, for those who think that they are Canadian citizens, American citizens, Peruvian citizens, Chinese citizens, Russian citizens, German citizens, or whatever, we do have some obligations of living in the societies that we're in. But we are supposed to obey God rather than men. The Bible is very clear about that. Now, how did Jesus deal with some of this stuff? If you go to the book of John, chapter 18, I alluded to it before, but I'd like to read John 18, starting in verse 35. Listen to the words of Jesus comes after Pilate talks to him. Pilate answered and said, am I a Jew? Your own nation, the chief priests, had delivered you to me. What have you done? Jesus answered. Again, notice what Jesus said. My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so I would not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. Now Jesus, currently speaking at the time, was a Jewish citizen. But his kingdom, his true citizenship, was not of the world. And the same reasoning applies to true Christians now, which is why we don't fight. Now, since the terrorist attacks are not a reason for an exception, what should be done? Well, that's not it's probably not practical, but it is easy if people would do it. The nation should repent. If people want God's protection, you can read about this in Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 through 7. It says, "Now it shall come to pass, you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, to carefully observe His commandments, which I command you today. The Lord your God will set you high among all nations, and all the blessings shall come on you and overtake you, because you obeyed the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed should you be in the city, blessed should you be in the country, blessed the fruit of your body, the produce of the ground, the increase of your herds, and increase your cattle, and the offspring of your flocks. Blessed shall your basket and your kneading bowl. Blessed shall be when you come in, blessed when you go out. The Lord will cause your enemies who rise against you to be defeated before your face, and they shall come against you one way, flee before you seven ways." And I'd like to continue in a moment, but just stop right there. This is what Melito was talking about. Remember Melito, the Christian bishop? Around 170, 180 time frame, he said, if people would obey God, God will provide the protection. I'm not going to go further, but if you go and read Deuteronomy 28:15-16 and 22-25, it basically says, if you don't obey, you're going to have all these problems. You're going to have problems with the military, you're going to have people trying to kill you, and all those kinds of things. Now, yes, it hurts if somebody bothers you or kills one of your relatives, but the Bible says vengeance is God's. And let's go to Romans chapter 12, verse 19. Read something that the Apostle Paul wrote. Romans 12, verse 19. "Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, shoot him." No, it didn't say that. "Feed him. If he's thirsty, give him a drink, for in so doing you'll heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." I believe that the New Testament makes it clear that Christians are not supposed to participate in carnal warfare and are not supposed to encourage violent sports. As far as with dealing with enemies, I read what the Apostle Paul said, but if you take your Bibles and go to the book of Matthew chapter 5, we know that Jesus said, you know, about murder, and you're not supposed to be angry for no cause. If you go down to verse 43, listen to this. Jesus said, "You've heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise in the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Don't even the tax collectors do the same? If you greet your brethren only, what do you have more than others? Don't even the tax collectors do this? Therefore, you shall be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect." So the standard is not to be like those in the world, not to be like those who compromise and to kill, but the standard is to be perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. Now, I'd like you to go to Matthew chapter 26. So go over several pages. But think about it again. Jesus is telling us, do not respond the way the world responds. And that's what he's telling us in Matthew 5. But notice that you don't love your enemy by engaging in war to try to kill him, nor encouraging violence in sports. And that, you know, when people watch things, sports, let's say American football, they're hoping that one side is going to crush, knock over the other side, which sometimes results in immediate injury, but a lot of times results in long-term injury. And the same thing when people are watching boxing. They want one side to win, generally speaking, which means someone else is getting pummeled, so that's their enemy. And that's not, you're supposed to love your enemy. You're not supposed to encourage violence. Now again, Matthew 26, let's read this. And suddenly one of those who were with Jesus reached out his hand and drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his ear. But Jesus said to him, "Put your sword in its place. All who take the sword shall perish by the sword. Don't you think I cannot now pray to my Father, and he'll provide me with more than 12 legions of angels?" So Jesus did not encourage violence, and he said, "Don't. That whoever takes up the sword is going to perish by the sword." Now I'd like to go to 1 John and read some things there. 1 John chapter 2, starting in verse 10. He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going, because darkness has blinded his eyes. Do you truly love your brother? Let's go over to the next chapter, 1 John 3. I'm going to start reading in verse 14. 1 John 3:14. He who does not love his brother abides in death. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer. And you know no murderer has eternal life abiding him. So those who hate don't abide in the light. They don't have eternal life. As Christians, be cautious. You're not supposed to hate. You're not supposed to do violence. You don't want others to do violence. Now some have asked what church people should do if they're being attacked. We're going to go to Matthew chapter 10, and I'll read the words of Jesus, and I'll make a couple other comments as well. Matthew 10, verse 23. When they persecute you in this city, flee to another. For assuredly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the cities of Israel before the Son of Man comes. So Jesus didn't say, okay, if they persecute you in this city, all get together, let's become some kind of vigilante band, and we'll be violent, and we'll be a warring party, and we'll stand our ground, and we won't let anybody take anything from us. Jesus said to persecute one city, flee to the other. Now, I'm not saying if somebody is physically pounding on you, you shouldn't attempt to restrain them or to protect yourself. But you can yell, run, or whatever. Again, try not to do violence. There's minimal violence to try to restrain somebody from hitting. But we're not supposed to be out trying to kill or to harm. Now, let's read what more about what Paul wrote in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. He wrote, "Therefore, I exhort, first of all, that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that why? That we might lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior." So we're supposed to pray to have a quiet and peaceful life. We're not supposed to intentionally get in circumstances or hang around with people who are going to be inclined toward violence and to cause us to participate in it, because we may get carried away in it. Now let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And read some more about how Christians should respond. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3. "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal." So Christians are not supposed to war according to the flesh. Others seem to do that. Now please go to the book of Ephesians, chapter 6. I'm going to start in verse 11, Ephesians chapter 6. Because he was talking about the weapons of our war are not carnal. Of our warfare. Ephesians 6, verse 11. "Put on the whole armor of God, that you may withstand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand an evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand, therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace." This is the gospel of peace. "Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now, he mentioned the gospel of peace. Well, that's also mentioned in Romans chapter 10, verse 15. Quote, "How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things." God's ministers are supposed to be teaching the gospel of peace. Now let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I'm going to read 1 Thessalonians 5, starting in verse 8. "But let us who are of the day be sober, put on the breastplate of faith and love, as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ." The gospel of peace, and we're not appointed to wrath. We're not supposed to decide we need to get all worked up to harm others, or to want others to harm others. We're supposed to know the gospel of peace. Now in Galatians chapter 5, in verse 19, we can read about the works of the flesh. "Now, the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery." So people agree with that. People in the Church of God agree with this. But sometimes they have more difficulty with these next items: hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you before, just as I told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Hatred, contentions, outbursts of wrath are things Christians are not supposed to participate in. Now in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14, it says, "Pursue peace with all peoples and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord." How can you participate in carnal warfare then? Because you're not pursuing peace with all people and holiness. You can't. Christians shouldn't be doing this. Now, 1 Corinthians 7, verse 15, the Apostle Paul wrote, "But God has called us to peace." God has called us to peace. He didn't call us to be in the military. And 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11, Apostle Paul said, or he wrote, "Finally, brethren, farewell. Be complete. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you." He's the God of love and peace. Remember, Jesus said we're supposed to be like our Father in heaven, who's perfect. Now we're going to go to Romans chapter 12. I'm going to read a few passages there, so you might want to go over there. Romans chapter 12, starting in verse 18. "If it is possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men." And that's what I said. You try to be peaceful. You try to be peacemakers. Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers." We're supposed to be peaceable. And as much as it's possible. So again, there may be times you have to stop somebody from actually harming you, but that should be very rare. "Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him drink. For in so doing, you'll heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Now, I realize I read this before. And why am I reading it again? Because people seem to think that they can avenge themselves, or that vengeance is fine. They can nurse a grudge and keep it. But the Bible's saying you're not supposed to do that. So I figured if I read it a couple of times, maybe that would make more of the point. Now, it's true that the resurrected saints, as it says in Jude verses 14 and 15, will crush Christ's enemies. But the saints aren't going to be physical humans at that time, as it says in 1 Corinthians 15, 51 and 52, as well as 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 and 17, will be changed at that stage. So while we're in the flesh, we're not supposed to be those who are participating in carnal warfare. Now, if you go to 1 Peter chapter 3, I'd like to read something that the Apostle Peter wrote about Christian behavior in this life. 1 Peter 3, starting in verse 10. 4. He who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. We're supposed to seek peace and pursue it. We're not supposed to seek war, train for war, and participate in war. Now, I'd like to read from Luke chapter 3, something that John the Baptist said. This is what he said when he was talking to the military. Actually, the military people asked him a question, so let me read this. Luke 3:14. Likewise, the soldiers asked him, saying, "And what shall we do?" And he said to them, "Do not intimidate anyone or accuse falsely, and be content with your wages." Now, this word that was translated there as intimidate is the Greek word diaseo, which the King James Version translates as violence. Strong's translated as to shake thoroughly, to shake down, if you will, to intimidate, to do violence. It comes from two words meaning diagnosis and seios. It's an examination, and seios is like a rock or to agitate, throw a tremor. There's no way a soldier cannot agitate or intimidate if there's no way they can't do that if they're actually trying to kill somebody. Now, some have said, look, it says to the soldiers, don't hurt them and be content with your wages. He didn't tell them they had to get out. That's true. But maybe they couldn't have gotten out. But they were still supposed to refuse to kill. Now, when I first came into the Church of God myself, I was actually in the military. And I asked the pastor, I said, "Do I need to get out of the military since I'm in the Church of God?" He asked what my job was, and I told him. He said, "Well, you're not doing anything violent." I said, "No." And he said, "Well, if let's say they make you do something you can't do, go ahead and stay in until your enlistment ends." And so I did. Now, this part about being content with your wages, I think part of this is also telling the soldiers, not only aren't you supposed to hurt somebody, you're not supposed to scare them into giving you their money either. So if you're not supposed to scare somebody, you're not supposed to intimidate them, you're not supposed to do violence to them, obviously you shouldn't be in the military. Now, in the book of Revelation, it says, if anyone has an ear to hear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity will go into captivity. He who kills the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and faith of the saints, Revelation 13:9-10. So even at the end, saints are to be patient and not among those who kill with the sword. It's no wonder that the Church of Rome and and Martin Luther discounted all this kind of stuff, because they felt that it was okay to do harm. Now, in the Bible, in Galatians 2:20, it states, "I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." Jesus Christ is not going to live in you if you're going to kill, hate, or participate in human warfare. And do you really think Jesus Christ would encourage violent sports, violent entertainment, such as boxing and American football? Now, in the 21st century, the Continuing Church of God has its official statement of beliefs, and I'd like to read some of this. It's going to take just a moment or so. This is a section called Not of This World. Jesus taught, quote, "My kingdom is not of this world," John 18:36. John the Baptist taught, "Do violence to no man," Luke 3:14, King James Version. Historically, those of the Church of God have considered military services wrong for its members. From Revolutionary War times to Civil War to present, countries like the United States have tended to have provisions to exempt Church of God members and congregants from military participation because of conscientious objections. Early Christians did not participate in military warfare nor watch violent sports. So that's from our official statement of beliefs. Continuing, the Apostle Paul taught, quote, "We are ambassadors for Christ," end quote, 2 Corinthians 5:20, Ephesians 6:20. The Apostle Peter taught that God's people were, quote, "a holy nation, his own special people, that we may proclaim the praise of him who called us out," 1 Peter 2:9. The Bible also teaches that this world's been deceived by Satan the devil, Revelation 12:9, and God's people need to separate from the world. John 15:19, 2 Corinthians 6:14-17, and Revelation 18:4. Thus, historically, the Church of God has taught its members not participate in secular juries or secular politics. However, Christians are expected to listen to and pray for governmental authorities and to pay their taxes, as it says in Matthew 22:17-21. Yet, if there's any conflict between the laws of men and the laws of God, quote, we must obey God rather than any human authority, Acts 5:29 NLT translation. And that position that the continuing Church of God has is consistent with the records of church history. And of course, as I mentioned before, that even the 3rd and 4th century, a lot of professors of Christ would not participate in the military. But as I've indicated before, the Church of Rome doesn't have that position anymore, neither do some other groups. I'd like to read something from Philip Van Ness Myers. He's talking about the Battle of the Milvian Bridge, 312 AD. Constantine, he'd been led to adopt the cross as an emblem through an appearance, as he once prayed to the sun god. A cross went over the setting sun and an inscription on it: in this sign you will conquer. Obedient to the celestial vision, Constantine had at once made the cross his banner, and it was beneath his new emblem as the soldiers marched to victory. Whatever may have been his circumstances or motive which led Constantine to make the cross his standard, this act of his constitutes a turning point in the history of the Christian church. Now, I don't think it's the true Christian church. Christianity had come into the world as a religion of peace and goodwill. That part's true. The master had commanded his disciples to put up their sword. For 2 centuries and more, obedience to his command by a large body of his followers had been so implicit that a Quaker non-military spirit had throughout this period characterized the new sect. So in other words, most people in the first couple centuries after Christ were basically like the Quakers in the Church of God people. They wouldn't fight. Some of the early church fathers, church leaders, taught that the profession of arms was incompatible with a true Christian life. That's true. But then this says, after the victory for the cross at the Milvian Bridge, a change passed over the Church of Rome and the Eastern Orthodox, not the Church of God. It leaned more and more upon earthly power and became militant. This infusion into the church of the military spirit of Rome was one of the most important consequences of the story of the miraculous cross in the sky and of the espousal of the so-called Christian cause by Emperor Constantine. And that's true. That was the problem. Up until that time, most people who professed Christ weren't going to be warriors. And if you're a Catholic, Eastern Orthodox Catholic or a Roman Catholic, and you think you have the original faith, and you believe what the Bible says, and you believe what the early traditions of the apostles were, you would not participate in carnal warfare, nor would you encourage it. And if you're a Protestant and you believe you have the faith of the Bible or the faith of the early Christians, you also would not do so. It's interesting that actually, according to a priest named Hushady in the 19th century, the type of cross, one of the types of cross that Constantine said could be one associated with the coming of the Antichrist. So I find that kind of interesting, talking about the Lateran cross. Now, Emperor Constantine was praying to the sun god. Emperor Constantine was a follower of sun god Mithras. And I'd like to read something about Mithraism. Now, this is from a Catholic priest named Aiken, and this is from the Catholic University Bulletin. Mithraism was first and foremost a military cult brought to these regions by foreign Mithra worships, who along with other Orientals were enlisted in the Roman army and stationed in numerous camps that dotted the extensive frontier of the north. Some of the Roman soldiers, even centurions and higher officers, became initiated in the mysteries of the victorious light god, and when afterwards they were sent to different parts of the empire. So it should be no surprise, Emperor Constantine, who was a follower of Mithra, and saw some kind of a cross when he looked at the sun, when he was praying to the sun god, felt that people should fight, because he was a fighting person. Now everybody, of course, didn't agree with this particular emperor. Around 332, Constantine decided to issue what was known as the Edict Against Heretics. And he started to talk about the Pelagians, who he called heretics, and he goes through all this. He says that they are evil, and this is just terrible that they can exist, and they are falsehood and defilement. So he proclaimed an edict against the faithful. Sadly, many were intimidated by his edict, and they went the wrong way. I'd like to read something from R.E. Chamberlain. He wrote a paper called Anti-Judaism in the Council of Nicaea. Quote, "More Christians were killed by other Christians," of course these weren't true Christians, "in the first century after the Council of Nicaea than had been killed by pagans in the century before Nicaea. Constantine, only 1 year after convening the Council of Nicaea, had his own son Crispus put to death. Later he suffocated his wife Fausta in an overheated bath. Then he had his sister's son flogged to death and her husband strangled. It was during the reign of Constantine that the cross became a sacred symbol for Christianity, just as it had been pagan religions." Well, again, we in the Church of God did not adopt that symbol. "Throughout his reign, Constantine treated the bishops as political aides. He agreed to enforce whatever opinion the majority of bishops formulated." So it was kind of a political alliance. The bishops got what they wanted. Constantine actually gave them lots of different things, including power and protection. And what do you want? He just wanted people to fight and to support him. Just like so-called great politicians and leaders throughout the world. Now, there were still problems with this. People knew it was still wrong. Now, in the 5th and 13th centuries, they came up with ways to try to justify this. Now, the I guess he's considered a doctor of the Catholic Church, Thomas Aquinas. Around the 13th century, he wrote down why people shouldn't fight. Here are the objections. It would always be sinful to wage war. Those who wage war are threatened by our Lord with punishment. According to Matthew 26:52, all who take the sword will be perish with the sword. Therefore, all wars are unlawful. Again, Thomas Aquinas is saying objections to war. War is contrary to the divine precept, for it's written in Matthew 5:39, "But I say to you not to resist evil." Romans 12:19, "Not revenging yourselves, my dearly beloved, but give place unto wrath. Therefore, war is always sinful." Again, he said, "War is always sinful. Warlike exercises which take place in tournaments are forbidden by the church," he said. Then he talks about, "We are told to do violence to no man and be content with your pay." That's what John the Baptist taught. "If he commanded them to be content with their pay, he did not forbid soldiering." See, now they're trying to justify it. But again, as I said, I think he said to be content with their pay so the soldiers wouldn't think, "We won't really hurt people, we'll just pretend and scare them, because they won't know that we're Christian soldiers. They'll think we might really hurt them like the non-Christian soldiers were." So I think that's why they were told to be content with their pay, and then to get out when then they should get out. Sadly, in the 14th century, the Roman Church ignored some of these objections, and so did St. Thomas Aquinas. They call him a saint. I did not. I do not. But it says, this is from something from the Catholic University of America, a doctoral dissertation that was submitted there. It says, "Both, therefore, the power of the Church," that is, the spiritual and material sword. So Church of Rome says they have those two swords. "The former is to be administered for the church, but the latter by the church. The former in the hands of the priest, the latter by the hands of kings and soldiers, but at the will and sufferance of the priest. However, one sword ought to be subordinated to the other, and the temporal authority subject to the spiritual power. Therefore, we declare, we proclaim, we define it's absolutely necessary for salvation of every human creature to be subject to the Roman pontiff." And this is from the bull Unum Sanctum, which was part of the doctoral dissertation I was referring to. All right, so what does this mean? In 1302, the Church of Rome says, we've got all the power, and we want the king to basically kill people on our behalf. And that they did that. And it says that, as far as the Inquisition goes, it was all related to that. For the medieval popes, the crucial factor that caused them to condemn dissidents was really the dissidents' rejection of papal authority. This is from the Protestant Harold Brown. He was reporting that, and that's true. People, Church of God people, who rejected papal authority, that's why they were killed. Pope Benedict XVI basically put out a paper when he was pope that said, the council calls members of the armed forces custodians of security. I urge you to ensure all military chaplains are authentic experts and teachers what the church teaches, with a view of building peace to the world. Soldiers in the service of peace. Church is missionary by nature, and it's for principal task evangelization. But the church is also called in the military world to be salt, light, and leaven. The armed forces are exclusive service for the security and freedom of the peoples. That's the one from John Paul's, he was quoting John Paul there, Benedict XVI. So in other words, the Church of Rome keeps saying, it's fine to go out and kill because that's what we teach, we being the Church of Rome. I'm going to read through, I guess make a few comments. As I mentioned before, in Ephesians 6:15, it talks about the gospel of peace. In Psalm 119:165, it says, great peace have those who love your law. Nothing causes them to stumble. And in the book of Micah, chapter 4, this is some prophecies related to Jesus, but also I think his people. Micah, chapter 4, verse 3. He shall judge many between many peoples, that's Jesus, and rebuke strong nations afar off. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn any war anymore. But everyone shall sit under his own vine and fig tree. No one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. Again, I read that from one of the early writers. Isaiah 2:4, it says the same basic thing, but it concludes with, neither shall they learn war anymore. Isaiah 9, verse 6, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulder. His name will be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it, to establish it with just judgment and justice from that time forward, even forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform it. So this is again from the Bible. Now, I've mentioned the Protestants a few times, and I should comment that Martin Luther was a Catholic before he was a Protestant. And in 1530, I'd like to read something that his followers declared. Article 16 of Civil Affairs. Of civil affairs, they teach lawful civil ordinances are good works of God, and it's right for Christians to bear civil office, to sit as judges by matters of the imperial existing laws, to ward punishments, to engage in just wars, to serve as soldiers. Okay, so the Protestants said in 1530 it's fine to be soldiers and to kill people and do all that kind of stuff. Then, in that same article, they condemned the Anabaptists who forbid these civil offices to Christians. So, in other words, those who went along with Martin Luther said it's okay to be soldiers, but they condemned Church of God types, or people who had beliefs similar to Church of God, who were opposed to it. Again, this also proves that in the 16th century, there were Church of God supporters, or people who support the Church of God beliefs, who did not believe that Christians are supposed to be soldiers, and to do that. Now, Martin Luther, in case you wondered, he advised killing Jews and others, and he said that was just. So, you know, I know he said just wars. Here, let me read specifically what Martin Luther advised his followers. This is from Luther's Works, Volume 20. Pages 2230 and beyond, to burn down Jewish schools and synagogues and to throw pitch and sulfur into the flames, to destroy their homes, to confiscate their ready money and gold and silver, to take from them their sacred books, even the whole Bible, and if that did not help matters, to hunt them out of the country like mad dogs. That's what Martin Luther advocated, Protestants. He also said in something called Table Talk, I, Martin Luther, slew all the peasants in the rebellion. For I said that they should all be slain. All their blood is upon my head. But I cast it on the Lord who commanded me to speak this way. So Martin Luther is saying God actually commanded him to speak like he's speaking, to go out and kill a whole bunch of peasants. And how many were killed? Well, according to the records I've seen, about 100,000 at that time. Martin Luther was a mass murderer. Those in the Protestant faith, most of the Protestant faith that I'm aware of, do believe that it's appropriate to participate in the military, to kill in the military, to participate in violent sports, and to encourage violent sports. But encouraging violence is evil, which is why being a fan of violent sports is wrong. People or Christians who have convinced themselves it's fine for them to not participate in the military, but to encourage violence in sports and other activities, they're deluding themselves. It's not right. Let's go over to Romans 13, verse 9. Paul wrote, if there's any other commandment, all are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Well, participating in the military and fighting against one harms one's neighbor. Encouraging violent sports harms one's neighbor. And it's a documented, proven fact that people are harmed with violent sports. Many in Church of God don't quite get it. Philadelphia Christians need to understand what love is all about. The term Philadelphia means love the brethren, or to love your, love not just your close brothers, but your neighbor. Real Philadelphia Christians should love their neighbor. They should not encourage violence to be done against them, or to glory in violence. I see people who are so happy one particular sports team destroyed or demolished another one. I don't believe that's Christian, especially when physical violence is occurring. You know, Jesus taught in Matthew 5:21-22, even certain thoughts are murder. Killing is evil. Vengeance belongs to God, as it says in Romans 12:19. If Christians aren't supposed to be violent, what's supposed to be done for peace? Christians are supposed to pray for it. If you go to Psalm 34, verse 14, it says, depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. In Psalm 122:6, it says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Now, I already read 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 3, but we're supposed to pray for all men, for kings, those who are in authority, that we might lead a quiet and peaceable life. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Now, when you're in the military, you're sort of a slave to the military. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 23, the Apostle Paul said to Christians, you were bought with a price. Do not become slaves of men. Therefore, you should not voluntarily enter military service. Now, I realize that you may be forced into doing some things that you don't want to do. And if you have to assist somehow, you can. But again, you're not supposed to harm anyone. This says in Acts 5:29, we ought to obey God rather than men. Military participation became part of mainstream so-called Christianity after one who embraced the sun god and who was part of the sun god militaristic religion adopted it. Should Christians do what he did or he advocated or rely on the Bible? Should we rely on the Bible or traditions of men? We're to love our enemies. We're supposed to pray for them. We're supposed to trust God. Christ's kingdom is not now of this world. The servants don't fight. It's sad that not all who claim to be Christian believe this. It's sad that not all who claim to be Christian will denounce violent entertainment, violence of encouraging violent sports. Christians are supposed to have the patience and faith of the saints, as it says in Revelation 13:10. We're supposed to love our neighbor. We're not supposed to do violence. We're not supposed to encourage violence. We, as Christians, are to love our neighbor as ourselves and not encourage violence in order to live as Jesus told his disciples and followers to live.